Ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, dear Rabbi Andrew Baker, it's a great pleasure for me to be here, the first time that I can attend the Promoting Tolerance program and to celebrate the 25th anniversary of this program. Over the course of 25 years, it has always been the program's greatest mission to advocate for human rights, to foster pluralism, to improve the rights of minorities. In other words, yes, to promote tolerance, the ambitious yet achievable goal of this program. But, ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, maybe in opposite to what we were hoping for when this program started in the early 90s, it has not yet become easier to promote tolerance. Nowadays, the foundation still works in countries at war or under really difficult political circumstances, countries that reject our values. Some challenges from the past are still there and new ones have emerged. Among others, Europe has been facing a series of crises that obviously weakens Europe's capacity to build, preserve, and strengthen a society based on inclusion, on tolerance, and equality. A society that is united in diversity, which fortunately still remains one of the guiding principles of the European Union. A few years back, the economic and financial crisis laid the foundation for the constitution and rise of new and already existing xenophobic groups and parties all over Europe. This was also an expression of pure dissatisfaction, and the refugee crisis then increased this phenomenon. Since then, bigotry and xenophobia, accompanied by the rise of right populism, have been shaping the public discourse, not only in Germany, but in several European countries as well as in the United States of America. Xenophobia and right populism are no new phenomena. No. However, lately their extent has reached a new level. In consequence, democratic governments are increasingly losing their bearings. Xenophobia has become a virus and it is further spreading. Both intolerance and bigotry are enemies of tolerance, democracy, and open societies. Both represent radical world views and far more dangerous. Both represent rather closed worldviews that leave very little room for different arguments and opinions, and both go hand in hand. Closed groups, closed worldviews do not accept or even tolerate external input. People that belong to these groups are usually not very familiar with different cultures, ideas, and ways of life. The problem is, humans have always been afraid of the unknown. Subsequently, over time, this lack of interest and curiosity generates an even greater fear of everything unknown and everything that is labeled as foreign. We can perfectly understand this tendency by analyzing the political situation and the recent election results in countries in the region of Central, East, and Southeast Europe that usually have rather small percentages of migrant workers, refugees, and foreigners in general. For example, in Poland, Jarosław Kaczyński and his Law and Justice Party have currently 57.2% of the seats in parliament. In Hungary, Viktor Orban and his party Fidesz have 52.1% of parliamentary seats and is the only governing party in Hungary. And in Germany, you know, unfortunately, the alternative for Germany has become popular in the whole country. The party is represented in 13 of the 16 regional parliaments of Germany, and most likely it will be part of the next German Bundestag. However, the alternative for Germany is particularly popular in German federal states that used to belong to the former DDR, for example, Lower Saxonia or Mecklenburg-Western Pomerania. They had around about 20 or 24% of the votes of the last elections. Both are federal states that have a relatively low rate of migration. Again, humans fear the unknown. Eventually, this creates a vicious circle of distrust and further isolation. Xenophobia is more of a symptom than a cause, a symptom for insecurity and the lack of knowledge. Nonetheless, let me underline that most certainly we can observe xenophobic tendencies in societies that have a long-standing history of migration as well. Against this background, the question is how to confront bigotry and intolerance in the face of rising populism. Often people tend to then modify the question themselves and ask, how should politics confront these challenges? That is a natural reflex and it is very understandable. As former German Minister of Justice and long-standing politician, let me make it very clear. Of course, politicians have the responsibility to do something. They must be vigilant to defend the model of enlightened societies inward and promote it onward. However, civil society, all of us, and this is the core of the Promoting Tolerance program, have the obligation to do something too. Start by asking ourselves, what can I do? By this I mean to challenge the arguments of those who are xenophobic and intolerant openly and aggressively. Unfortunately, we probably have to deal with populist parties and xenophobic movements for a while to come. They prove a momentum to the generally Eurosceptic, illiberal, and authoritarian tendencies currently triumphing in Eastern Europe and elsewhere. Fortunately, not in France and in the Netherlands. Their success should serve as a warning bell to us. Liberals in the whole of Europe and beyond. A growing number of people are becoming increasingly willing to tolerate xenophobic tendencies from parties that offer them a sense of community and security and advocate a policy of nationalism. Xenophobia and intolerance have many different faces. Both have roots in different social groups, different age groups, different environments. We have to be aware of this. Our responses have to be as different as their questions, their arguments, and their fears. Some people, however, have taken the opposite approach, not by challenging the arguments of those who are xenophobic, but by appropriating them. Why do they do so? Should not history teach us better? I often experience that people tend to believe that conditions are much different than they used to be, that democracy is far more institutionalized. But let me tell you, the opposite is true. The risk is that democracy, open societies, human rights, and tolerance are taken for granted because they are institutionalized. Conventional wisdom has always suggested that populists cannot come into power, which most recently the US election have proven wrong. We can stay in Europe and again look in the direction of Hungary and Poland to understand that this assumption is no longer valid. Ignoring this reality will not make it go away. On the contrary, if we don't respond adequately to this dynamic, we might all soon wake up in a Europe and a world where parties similar to PIS, to Fidesz, and to AfD in Germany have suddenly become the mainstream. That is why we have to defend our values. The values that liberals represent, an open society, the defense of minority rights, the freedom of the individual and tolerance. These are declared enemies of xenophobic populist movements. Our values directly contradict xenophobia and intolerance. Xenophobic people feel strong as part of a large group. Most certainly, liberalism that aims to empower the individual is a very strong opponent. This makes me even prouder to call myself a liberal, no over 39 years. Subsequently, this brings us to the important question. As liberals, as Europeans, as defenders of democracy, what can we do to promote tolerance and stop the rising populism? As you know, lately everyone speaks about the so-called post-truth age. You have probably noticed that discussions about xenophobia and populism often result in a decline in rational discourse. What are we witnessing at the moment has a whole new quality. Fake news are not new. It's an old phenomenon. Fake news have been used as a powerful tool during campaigns and after. This populist appeal has been reinforced by the dissatisfaction of the people and the increasing perception that governments are unable to overcome the challenges posed. My best advice would be to repeatedly ask people that have xenophobic views, ask them about their sources, about the background of the information they are sharing. This is the best way to expose rumors and fake news. Tell them about your own take of the situation. Engage in a discussion. Do not isolate them, but make a powerful counter speech. To combat xenophobia, particularly as a liberal, means to defend and to protect our civil liberties. In the face of all current threats, such as terrorism, we have to stress the importance of the rule of law, among others. Unfortunately, we have witnessed how leaders in Hungary and Poland have been dismantling those civil liberties and transformed the liberal democracy into an illiberal democracy. However, in most cases, liberal democracies do not fail because of the strength of anti-democratic movement, but because the democratic government and the democrats themselves are not able to uphold its values against its enemies. Never, never underestimate the power of self-destruction. I'm convinced that diversity can be, and in most cases is, a strength that people societies to flourish. That is the reason why it is so important to combat xenophobia. In conclusion, that we as citizens, activists, and politicians can do is to take stock of the situation and show zero tolerance to xenophobia. We cannot allow that xenophobia and intolerance puts our liberal democratic values at risk. We cannot allow that people who are narrow-minded become the mainstream. I think the Promoting Tolerance program is one of the best way to combat these challenges. So I'm very happy to be here for the first time and to join with you this 25th anniversary. Thank you so much.